This isn't going to be a video with some grand narrative, I'm afraid. I thought it would be cool to set up an intercom system out to the shop using old phones, and that's what I did. So here's how. Now, first of all, by old phones, I mean really old phones. About as old as you can get, in fact. The hand crank wall phone was the standard from the early 1890s into the 1930s, slowly replaced by the more compact desktop models that are themselves now slowly dying away. Originally, these were all local battery systems, meaning each phone had its own set of batteries to power it. These were pretty simple systems, but while limited in functionality, they were very reliable. You could run these over wires in a barbed wire fence, for God's sake. They're still sometimes called railroad phones, because the railroads kept using them for decades after everyone else. And if there's one thing railroads love, beyond shooting themselves in the foot with arcane accounting practices, it's simple and reliable technologies. Now, there was a lot of variations in the systems offered, but the circuit at the heart of them is incredibly simple. You have a variable resistance microphone called a transmitter. DC current flows in a loop from the battery, through the primary side of a small transformer, and then through the transmitter. Talking into the transmitter causes changes in its resistance, causing fluctuations in the current flowing in this loop. On the secondary side of the transformer is the speaker, called a receiver, and the lines heading out to the rest of the world. The small changes in current are amplified by the transformer, and that's what creates sound in all the receivers connected to the lines. There is also a mechanical ringer and a generator in parallel across these lines. Human voice can be transmitted with low current, but to bang a metal clapper against bells with electromagnets? That needs some real power. This was provided by the generator, or magneto, turned via the error-defining crank on the side of the phone. This generates AC at about 70 volts, and let me personally assure you, you can very much feel it if you're carelessly touching the wrong wires when you turn the crank. On these old models, the transmitter was fixed to the box, and you only held the receiver up to your ear. There were also desktop models going almost as far back, with a wall box that still contained batteries, generator, transformer, and bells, but with a handset that combined both transmitter and receiver for more convenient use while sitting at a desk. There was actually one of these wall boxes, long disused, still mounted on the wall in my grandparents' place when I was a kid. But note a bit of interesting linguistic drift here. A telephone handset is still often called a receiver. Even though they've been both receiver and transmitter for over a century now. At some point, we just collectively decided that receiver didn't mean speaker, it meant thing you hold up to your face, and, well, that's how languages work. Anyway, you can have quite a few phones on a pair of lines like this, spanning many miles. But it's a party line, meaning they're all connected together. If you want to make a call and someone else is already on the line, you're just going to have to wait. And if you want to call someone who isn't on your local line, you're going to have to ask the operator to connect your lines to their lines, creating a new circuit. And when there's an incoming call on your line, all the phones would ring. You'd be assigned a ring pattern, and you'd have to listen for it before picking up to make sure it was meant for you. There were soon some systems for selective ringing, either harmonically tuned ringers that would only resonate at certain AC frequencies, or biased ringers that would only respond to certain polarities. I'm not sure how common these ever actually were, but their address space was limited to about 4, so it wasn't exactly a huge improvement anyway. This is a significant limitation to the technology, but if you're just setting up an intercom system for 2 people, it doesn't really matter. So my plan was find some old phones, hook them up to the phone line that already runs out to the shop. Some poking around on the usual suspects landed me these 2. A gorgeous, very early model cathedral-style wall phone, with a decorative picture frame and exaggerated finial with exposed wire terminals and the carbon disc lightning arrestor. This one would go inside, nicely complementing the remodeling that Alexis has been doing for a kind of maximalist Edwardian parlor look. And I also found a later, more industrial model with a combined handset instead of the separate receiver and transmitter, which would go nicely out in the shop. But both are local battery phones, so I was looking forward to how simple it would be to set everything up. As usual, reality ended up being a bit more complicated than that. The handset phone was pretty much ready to go, but its generator was very stiff. So I took it apart, cleaned everything up, and lubricated it, at which point it was working fine again. Unfortunately, in the process, this little non-conductive nub broke off. This gets pushed out as you start to turn the crank, switching the line so that your local ringer is no longer connected. Without it, you'd be ringing your own ringer, which would be loud and annoying, and a waste of hand-cranked power. To replace the nub, I turned down the section of the useless plastic stands that came with these digital photo frames, which I was experimenting with as a cheap way to have video loops playing at my open source booth this year. With a bit of shaping, it fit nicely into the end of the shaft and can hopefully provide another century of service for this phone. I was much less worried about the indoor phone because it seemed to be in such immaculate condition. This style was first offered in 1896, and while they did make them for a long time afterwards, smaller and sleeker models were already being offered just 2 years later. So this is roughly as old as my great-grandparents, the last of whom died in 1978. It's really astonishing how good of a condition it's in. This is what I found when I opened it. A generator and a ringer, and not much else. Nothing was connected to the hook switch, the transformer was missing entirely, and what was left of the wiring didn't make much sense. It looks like someone gutted it, then tried to wire it up as a display piece, so turning the generator would make the bell ring. Getting it working again was going to be an interesting challenge, but what was there seemed to be in okay condition at least. The receiver made audible clicks from the test current when I hooked it up to a multimeter, and while the resistance across the transmitter was higher than it should be, leaving the phone vertical and tapping the transmitter occasionally to resettle the carbon granules inside helped a lot, as recommended by the book I was following. The generator, with a patent date of July 17, 1894, worked fine but was adorably chunky. These huge U's are the permanent magnets, and they're so weak they could barely lift a screwdriver. First, the receiver hook had to be fixed. This disconnects the main line, so there aren't conversations murmuring out of the receiver all the time. But it also disconnects the battery from the primary loop, meaning that the battery isn't being drained unless the receiver is off the hook and presumably you're on a call. Mostly just tightening everything up fixed the switch's behavior, but once again the little non-conductive nub was missing. This is a double-pole, single-throw switch, since there are two separate circuits being made and broken by it. Without something non-conductive here, not only would A connect to B and C to D, but everything would be connected to everything. I was able to use the same scrap plastic to make another little rounded nub. This time, there was just a tiny hole in the sheet metal of the switch to mount it on, so after pushing the tail through, I heated up a bit of metal and heat riveted it into place. Worked well. I managed to find an antique transformer and capacitor on eBay, and happily, they both still worked. The capacitor was still within 16% of its original nominal 1 microfarad, which is pretty impressive. I ended up only using the transformer, but oh well, the capacitor is really only needed for larger systems anyway. Using that and the circuit diagrams in the book and the one on the inside lid of the shop phone, I was able to rebuild a working circuit. First, just using alligator clip patch cables and later wired in permanently. I wanted the wiring to look at least moderately accurate, so I tracked down some cloth-covered wire to use. Turns out people still sell that for use in electric guitars if you ever have a need for it. It's kind of a pain to work with, though. My magical wire strippers, which I've seen working miracles with the impossibly fine wires inside EL wire, were almost useless, leaving a nasty mess of frayed threads whenever I tried. I was forced to resort to bad old techniques of rolling the wire onto a blade with just enough pressure to cut the jacket but not the core or yourself. But it worked, and I think it was worth the extra effort. Think what a bummer it would be to open this up and see a bunch of brightly colored modern insulation. Local battery phones need, well, local batteries. Traditionally, these were big dry cells, two of which were still in the shop phone when I got it. For that one, rough and tumble as its life is likely to be, I was happy to leave those two antique batteries in there and just shove a D-cell mount in behind them. But for the much prettier indoor phone, I wanted something a bit more classy. Luckily, someone makes reproduction dry cells in the style of the classics, with a variety of different labels to choose from, all scanned from originals. Inside are just two modern D-cells in parallel, so it's easy to replace them as needed. And I think they look pretty great once mounted properly. Finally, it was time to mount the phones permanently. That meant figuring out the wiring in the house, which meant a trip upstairs. This was only marginally helpful, sadly, because the wiring in the house is a palimpsest of at least three distinct phases of occupation. There are multiple phone drops that are now entombed and inaccessible behind drywall, two separate phone lines installed at different times, plus some point-to-point data lines that I still don't quite understand. But between that and opening up every wall socket I could find, I managed to figure out the basics. Luckily, as none of this is in use anymore, I just had to figure out how to get the phone line that runs out to the shop down a wall to someplace useful. I drilled a hole in the wall in the living room, and in what I thought was the correct section of the top plate up in the crawl space. But I wasn't having any luck with the fish tape, and looking into the hole, I couldn't even see any light from the living room below to help convince myself that I had drilled into the correct interstud space. So I solved both problems simultaneously by lowering a length of LED tape down from the top. The glow was plainly visible when I got back downstairs, yay, and it made fishing it out with a clothes hanger really easy. This was then used to daedalus some twine back up the hole, and then that pulled the phone lines back down and out. Then the phone was wired in and mounted permanently. On the shop side, it was, thankfully, a lot simpler, due to the much more accessible attic space and generally worrying less about the aesthetics. I mounted the phone in the inner shop, right by the doorway leading in, to try and maximize the area from which I might hear it ring. And with that, the intercom system was done. And how does it work, you might ask? Yes, Mr. B?
Mr. Watson, yes, come here, I need you.
I'll be right in.
Well, it's not the clearest or loudest voice channel I've ever used. But as long as there aren't any loud background noises, it's totally usable.
And let's be honest, we'll mostly just be using the ringer to tell the other side to check their damn phone and respond to a text already. In fact, we've already established a ring pattern for that. One if by landline, two if by airwaves. And that's it for 2024. It's been a big year for the channel, and I want to say a big, big thank you to everyone out there who's watched the videos and commented and liked and subscribed this year. You are subscribed, right? Right? Channel growth remains bumpy and unpredictable, but when it spikes, it really spikes. The intercom was just one of the big three projects that have been dragging on forever, but the others are getting close as well. For those who liked my ridiculous two-thirds keyboard, I'm hoping I can introduce you to a far, far more ridiculous one by the end of January. And by then, the stained glass kinetic sculpture video shouldn't be far behind. But even as I'm editing this, I've been working on setting up my latest shop acquisition, a Deckel KF1 pantograph engraving mill. That will definitely need to be featured in a video, along with a project to help me properly explore its new capabilities. Like custom waffle plates, I'm thinking, if all goes well. There's already a lot in the works for 2025, is what I'm saying. So cheers, and Happy New Year, everyone. Let's hope it's a good one.